The Bible teaches us that God's people should not be ignorant of Satan's devices. But please, do not allow the devil to twist this principle to stir up a hunger or fascination for the occult. This video is not meant to stir up such a hunger or fascination. Neither is it my motivation to encourage you to study the occult. Please do not allow the devil to tempt you through a spirit of curiosity to get hooked on studying the practices in the occult. Even though God leads us in a mighty wind to inform his people of the devil's schemes and the plots of his servants, there is always a balance we prayerfully maintain in this. Our main focus is to be on Yahushua, Jesus Christ, and living a loving, obedient relationship with him, rather than on the devil and studying what he is doing. We only go where God tells us to go, and only do what he anoints us to do. This is when we are protected by the blood of the Lamb. If a person goes on a journey to study the enemy without the guidance of the Holy Spirit, there is no protection, and this is spiritually very dangerous. This is the werewolf reality. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 28 to 30, "He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sore punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, and hath counted the blood of the covenant, wherewith he was sanctified, an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. For we know him that hath said, Vengeance belongeth unto me. I will recompense, saith Yahweh. And again, Yah shall judge his people." These and other verses in the Bible clearly teach us that, yes, an individual can lose his or her salvation. As a matter of fact, someone who loses his salvation is worse off in the day of judgment than someone who has never known the salvation and the grace of God that he displayed in his only Son, Yahushua HaMashiach, who gave his life for mankind on Calvary's cross, shedding his innocent, precious, and holy blood for the sins of man. Throughout the Bible, in the Old Testament, we see many examples of evil men and women that were born for the very purpose of destruction. Individuals that crossed the line, who went so far in defying the Most High God and testing his patience and vexing his Holy Spirit that there was no way back ever again to know the goodness or the grace or the salvation of an Almighty God. Those individuals were called reprobate silver because God rejected them. The reprobates of old underwent severe judgment. But one would ask, if they didn't have the blood of Yahushua HaMashiach to transgress against, yet underwent such severe punishment and wrath of the Almighty, what will be the punishment of the modern day reprobate men and women who claim the very inheritance of the Messiah through his name and blood, yet pollute, defile, mock, and trample on that same blood that they claim saves them and covers them, as they are reprobate unto every good work, and as they engage in willful sin, and proclaim that Jesus came for such purposes that they would be able to sin and still attain God's mercy. They fight against holiness. How much worse will their punishment be? King Nebuchadnezzar, in times of old, didn't even know the coming Messiah, Yahushua HaMashiach. Neither did he transgress against the blood of Yahushua, for that blood was still to be shed at that time in the future on Calvary's cross. Yet, when Nebuchadnezzar stole the honor and glory that belongs to Yahweh God, Yahweh cursed him and gave him the heart of a wild beast. Nebuchadnezzar was struck with insanity and turned into a man-beast, living amongst wild beasts. His body grew hair like eagle's feathers, and his nails became like claws of a bird. If God punished the heathen Nebuchadnezzar in such a manner, how much worse punishment will God dish out to those who claim to be His people and claim to know His Son, Yahushua HaMashiach, yet prove by their very actions they defy and hate everything God stands for. The question is, does God still curse the disobedient, the rebellious, and the reprobate as He did King Nebuchadnezzar today? Does He in likewise manner punish those who claim to know Him, yet continuously grieve His Holy Spirit and trample His Son's grace underfoot today? The Bible teaches us that God's judgments in these last days would not only be the same as in times of old, as the former judgments were an example and a warning for future generations of the fate of the rebellious, but His judgments would be multiplied and more severe. In other words, there is no reason whatsoever to believe that similar punishments, as in the case of Nebuchadnezzar, would not occur again. Man being turned into beast. Romans chapter 1 verse 28 and other Bible verses tell us that those who cross the bloodline of the Savior Yahushua HaMashiach through sin, idolatry, and willful rebellion will be given over to a reprobate mind. So they shamelessly corrupt themselves in all manner of sin, which works together for their own destruction. The Bible in several places refers to reprobate men and women as wild or brute beasts. Could it even be that in certain cases, reprobate men and women themselves purposely and shamelessly corrupt themselves in such a manner to consciously attain the very curse of turning into a beast, claiming it to be a quote-unquote blessing from their master Satan? Please listen to this short excerpt, which is a testimony of former Satanist and Freemason Bill Schnobelen. I add this warning though, we do not endorse Bill Schnobelen or his ministry, neither the prophecy club on which he is speaking. They invite both good and bad, but many true prophets are not welcome. And although we prayerfully discern Bill Schnobelen's testimony is true, we also discern he compromises by sometimes intentionally withholding information. So my purpose with showing you these excerpts is not to lead you to Bill Schnobelen or the Prophecy Club.
This picture, I'm going back one here, looks very much like a real werewolf. And I've seen a real werewolf. They are very imposing. Only high-level Satanists are gifted with this anointing. You can't, it's not like in the movies where if you are bitten by a werewolf, you become a werewolf. It's not that simple at all. In fact, you don't want to know how you become a werewolf. It's not fit for innocent ears, but it's so horrifying and depraved, I don't even want to go into it. In the Brotherhood, there are 10 degrees, like, you know, first degree, second degree, third degree. These are grades of achievement. And when you get up to seventh degree, you become what is called an adeptus exemptus, which means you're an adept, someone who's very good at doing something, and exempt means you're beyond morality. You're exempt from good and evil. At this point, there is a fork you have to take in the road in this particular flavor of Satanism that I was in. One way is to become a vampire, one way is to become a werewolf. I chose the way to become a vampire because I thought it was sexier somehow, and I'd heard that becoming a werewolf was extremely painful. This is considered a good thing in Satanism. There was a Satanist in the early part of the last century called Austin Osmond Spare, and he came up with a doctrine of atavistic resurgence, which is you should try and reclaim the beast part of yourself. You should try and become a beast. You should literally try and transform yourself into a beast. Now in 1966, a key year, that was the year that Anton Zandvoort LaVey founded the Church of Satan. And one of the first things he did was resurrect this doctrine of atavistic resurgence. In the Satanic Bible, which he wrote, one of the more evil books you'll ever read, he says that man is a beast, no better and often worse than the four-footed variety. And so therefore, we should embrace our beastliness. We should become gentlemen and lady beasts. Satanists of most stripe to this very day are encouraged to do this very kind of thing. And becoming a werewolf is considered the ultimate achievement in that.
Testimonies are out there of individuals who can testify to the reality of werewolves in satanic covens, which is a reality that Satan has tried hard to keep a secret. As Satan mocks this generation through the movies, people do not even understand that this stuff is real. As the coming of the Son of Satan is near, and a satanic world order is being fulfilled, this generation is being recruited into hardcore Satanism and satanic ideology through the entertainment industry. Now, where am I going with all this? The ministry I represent is an international evangelic ministry in 25 languages preaching the gospel of Yahushua HaMashiach, who many prefer to call Jesus Christ. And we are reaching souls with the prophetic messages that God has spoken through Prophet Elizabeth Elijah. The very foundation of this ministry is Yahushua, our Savior and Lord God Almighty. Salvation only comes through Him. And we teach true biblical repentance of sins and living a holy life. Those that come to this ministry are being tested and convicted by the Holy Spirit. Some accept the truths in this ministry, most reject it, just as the majority rejected Yahushua himself. Then there is another category, and it's those that appear to receive this ministry as a blessing and then turn Judas. When things get hard and they get tested by God, are they really walking the talk? Are they willing to turn away from sin? Are they willing to live holy? Are they willing to sacrifice what God tells them to lay on the altar, even if it means dividing from unsaved loved ones, spouses, friends, or family? Are they willing to help this ministry to reach souls for the kingdom of heaven? The Judases come and the Judases go. They come enthusiastically, often with a lot of talk. Then they get tested, and then they give up. They can't live holy or give up their sin. The first temptation Satan throws at them is to seek for an excuse to doubt this ministry and to be divided from this ministry, and sadly, to attack this ministry. To have an excuse to attack this ministry is for them a way to feel better about themselves and the decision that they made to turn away from holiness. A solid example is the individual who goes by the username of SondaClarais777 on YouTube. Whereas this man is one of the most ineffective enemies against the AmightyWind Ministry, and one of the most boring individuals you will ever come across, what you are about to learn about this man is anything but boring. Sander is an example of a Judas who once joined AmightyWind Ministry, yet later fell away from the truth and joined with our enemies on YouTube. There was a time that I took this man into my own apartment and we lived together as brothers in the Lord. The vow was to serve the Lord together, live holy, and to preach the gospel on the streets. I remember defending the holy prophecies that were spoken through Pastor Elizabeth Elijah together with him in front of his former church, where his former pastor aggressively opposed the truth Sander had found in the AmightyWind Ministry that he had tried to share. At the time, I loved Sander dearly. I remember drinking coffee with him and talking for hours about the Lord till we had tears in our eyes because of meditating on the goodness of God. But there was a problem. Sander was a rebellious brother. As time went by, the rebellion got worse. He did not keep his promises and repeatedly brought sin into the household and continuously longed to go back to Egypt, so to say. A place where people had betrayed him, hated him, and continuously hindered him in his walk with the Lord. He had his eyes on finances and ambition rather than the things of heaven. Due to repetitious sin and unholy behavior without repentance, God used Prophet Elizabeth Elijah to rebuke Sander in a prophetic word, warning him for the sake of his soul. Part of that rebuke became Prophecy 106, "I, Yahweh, say, clean your house." Sander did not change his ways, and his pride could not handle a rebuke. Months after this rebuke, he got rebuked and warned again. And the next thing he did is seek for an excuse to doubt Elizabeth was a prophet, so that in his own mind, he wouldn't have to acknowledge the rebuke Yah gave through Elizabeth. Whereas he previously wholeheartedly seemed to receive the holy prophetic messages in the Mighty Wind Ministry, now he started to pick apart the holy prophecies. He suddenly left the apartment, and I never saw or heard from him again. After about a year, when we in the Mighty Wind Ministry found ourselves in the midst of a war against Satanists masquerading as Christians, targeting Prophet Elizabeth Elijah with character assassination through slanderous lies and propaganda, Sander out of nowhere popped up on YouTube, first under a different username. It was only a matter of time before he allowed himself to be recruited by our enemies, joining them in their onslaught against this ministry. And his purpose was to purposely misquote, misuse, and misinterpret the Holy Bible so he could use the Bible as a weapon against a Mighty Wind Ministry, bashing the holy prophecies he once seemed to dearly hold to his heart. Now, being joined together with main enemy Pastor George C. and his Nehemiah Center, and individuals linked to George such as Naphtali 1981, Vampire Lover LiftAloft, and crosswayokc, who are all heavily involved in the occult, we knew that Sander in one way or the other was being initiated into the occult. Naphtali 1981, who plays around with hardcore Satanism, howling like a werewolf in a video promoting slander against the Mighty Wind. And crosswayokc, the voodoo priest. And George, who is one of the people pulling the strings behind these individuals. These were Sander's new brothers. Now, putting this puzzle together, is it any wonder that on April 7, 2012, Sander's ex-wife got in touch with Pastor Elizabeth Elijah in PMs? This is what she wrote. Username and avatar are partially censored for the protection of this woman. Hello, Yas Lady in Red. My name is, and I am the ex-wife of Sander. I write you this PM because I want to apologize for not listening to you in 2008. A lot of things are happening in my life. My husband and I are divorced in 2009. After my husband left AmightyWind Ministry, we tried to come together and restore our marriage. Things didn't work out very well, because I believe Yahweh already unyoked us. So I left the house with the children in June 2011, and we live somewhere else. What I'm going to say is very strange, but I hope you believe me. In the beginning of 2011, my husband was acting very strange in the night. When I was going to bed, he was going for a walk. In the backyard, I heard strange howling sounds. This was going on for several months until I took a look. What I saw was terrible. My husband was actually changed in a werewolf. These changes were only temporarily. In the morning, he is returning in his normal form. I couldn't believe my eyes, but it's true. The moment I saw that was the moment I have more interest in your website. May the Lord bless you and your ministry. Then a second message from Sander's ex-wife to Yas Lady in Red, who is Elizabeth Elijah. Hello, Yas Lady in Red. When I was looking back at my period with Sander after 2009, I saw once a very strange thing. At 11 o'clock in the evening, I saw that Sander had sex with the muffler of a car. After he finished, I asked him what he was doing with the car in the backyard. He told me he was trying to fix a hole in the muffler of our car. The next morning when I tried to start the car, I heard very strange sounds. After a few restarts, the engine of the car finally started. I still heard the hole in the muffler of our car, so I drive to the garage to let it fix. The mechanic told me that he had to replace the whole muffler. Another strange thing about my ex-husband is the fact that he makes long walks on the cemetery. Once when we split up, I followed him, and I saw him walking on the cemetery. He can walk for hours at the cemetery looking at the graveyards. After that, he goes home. In 2009 and 2010, he was, in my opinion, a good father towards his children. Since our split up, he doesn't visit his children very often. 1 hour in the 2 or 3 months. I will try to make a movie about him when he is howling in the backyard. Financially, he takes good care of us because he pays double alimony each month. I don't know what he pays at the Nehemiah Center because we split up. He takes care of his own finances. All I know is that he takes good care of us financially, but he doesn't visit his children very often. The man I once loved is changed in a very lonely man. I will talk more later. God bless. As you can see, after she was asked if she could provide any evidence of what she had witnessed, Sanders' ex-wife was willing to try to make a video of Sanders' transformations and share it with us. This courageous woman proceeded on making a recording at night of Sanders' activities and his transformation. Her words to me in a private message, written in Dutch, was that she wanted me to make this footage public to warn the people of what happens when a person disobeys God. What you are about to see are recordings that were done in the dark, at night, and I have tried my best to somehow make things more visible by playing with the lighting in my movie maker. In any case, if anyone would doubt that this is really Sander, I can say with confidence that after showing you the footage, I can present visual and audible proof that it's really him. If you belong to the Lord, be prayed up and covered with the blood of the Lamb, and bind any demons that may be attached to the following footage away from you. This is not appropriate for children to see. If you study this footage carefully, then you should be able to see that the shape of this individual's head and the body type matches the head of Sander and the body type of Sander. Furthermore, I want to replay the following audio in which you can hear Sander during his growling at one particular point cough, and that cough matches Sander's cough in many of his videos that are uploaded on YouTube.
Mate. Mate.
Please let us take another look at the key points that we got earlier on from the excerpt of Bill Snowblin's testimony concerning werewolves and satanic covens. There are real werewolves. Literally trying to transform into a beast is a real satanic doctrine that is part of the Church of Satan. The seventh degree in certain kinds of satanic brotherhoods involves the decision to become either a vampire or a werewolf. Becoming a werewolf is considered an ultimate achievement in Satanism. Only high-level Satanists are quote-unquote gifted with this false and evil and occult quote-unquote anointing. In order to become a werewolf, one must do such horrible and depraved things, Bill didn't even want to talk about it. These key points are furthermore confirmation that these men, and the men and the women who are in one way or the other associated with them, must have initiated Sander into high-level Satanism for Sander to have obtained this so-called quote-unquote ultimate achievement in Satanism. At the same time, they recruited him against AmightyWind Ministry and against Prophet Elizabeth Elijah. All these changes happened in Sander's life after he betrayed AmightyWind Ministry and played into the hands of these individuals and joined them. These men who programmed Sander and are pulling the strings behind him to attack a ministry that leads souls to Yahushua, Jesus Christ, in more than 25 languages are yet again confirmed to be high-level occultists who pose as Christians and Messianic Jews on YouTube, but behind the scenes are initiating people into the occult. What does this furthermore mean? What are the specific dangers of Sander being a werewolf? Let's take a short look at some more footage of Bill Snowblin's testimony.
True werewolves function as guards or assassins for the Brotherhood. The other thing is that they're assassins. They can kill somebody and, you know, oh, it's a wild animal attack. She told us that she felt she needed deliverance. And she was a Christian. And I said, well, why is that? And she says, well, for one thing, my ex-husband's a Mormon. But for another thing, the last time we had sex, he had dragged me down the stairs by my feet to the basement of our home, pushed a door, a button, and a secret part of the basement opened up. There was this satanic altar in there. There were all these people in there. He threw on the altar. They tied her up. And he turned right before her eyes into a werewolf. And he proceeded to rape her as a werewolf. And she had the scars to prove it.
Now, adding up these key points to the former, we can conclude that Sander, being involved with hardcore Satanism and being a werewolf, is a life-threatening danger to not only the people around him, but society in whole. Then not to mention the potential sexual danger he is to his ex-wife, his children, and again, society in whole, especially considering his bizarre sexual practices with his car that his own ex-wife recorded. In the days leading up to the making of this video, God gave me a vision in the spirit as I woke up in the morning, and I saw a man figure slain on the streets. As I looked at the man's body from afar, I thought it was Sander, but as God gave me a closer look, I saw that the slain man was not Sander, but I received the interpretation that Sander, as a werewolf, was the one who had slain this man. Whether this has already happened, or whether it is only a matter of time before this happens, I don't know. But I do know this. The prayers of the righteous avail much, as the Word of God says. Please stand in agreement with our prayers that this reprobate man who sold out to Satan will be locked up in jail or in a mental institution before anybody either gets attacked, raped, or killed. Please pray that Yahweh will render vengeance on this Satanist in the name of Yahushua HaMashiach for the sake of innocent people and children's lives. If God Himself does not intervene, as the vision I received already revealed, it is only a matter of time before something worse happens than the molestation of a car. Now to you, the viewer, have you believed and partaken in the lives of these men and those associated with them? After seeing this video, you are now held accountable more than ever. This is another example of satanic initiation carried out by these men and those associated with them. Rebuke these reprobate men and the women associated with them in the name of Yahushua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, and come out from among them. Help us to warn the people, and specifically the Christian community, of the evil that is transpiring in their midst. We have a mandate from heaven, and that is Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 17 to 21. We sound the trumpet and warn, so the blood will not be on our hands, and nobody will have an excuse before God. For everybody who claims to be a true born-again believer and follower of Yahushua, Jesus Christ, you have that same mandate. Will you be a watchman on the wall and help us get these truths out to the people so lives will be spared, people will be warned, and the lost will come to the saving grace of Yahushua HaMashiach as they are shaken up by the realization that Satan's kingdom is real and there is a battle going on for their souls? Or will you remain quiet and do nothing? It's your choice. But know this day, especially those that have believed the lies of these Satanists about the Mighty Wind Ministry and Prophet Elizabeth Elijah, you have no excuse. You are held accountable more than ever for the damage you have done, directly or indirectly, to this ministry or the faith of Yahushua's sheep and lambs who were chased away from this ministry with slanderous lies. May the fate of this man and the curse that is upon this man be an example to all of you of what happens to the enemies of Yahushua HaMashiach. May you realize that God, this very day, still curses the disobedient and the rebellious, just as he did in times of old. God has never changed. He is the same today, yesterday, and forever.